Comparison to last year, Colorado's forecast for 2018 pheasant season. We're going to be right around that average mark. Conditions weren't optimal for nesting and brood rearing this year, but they weren't bad either. It was pretty dry last winter, which means that there wasn't a lot of soil moisture early. So green wheat and early brood rearing habitat didn't get an early start this year. It certainly wasn't terrible, but it just wasn't what we'd consider optimal. It got wet in May, which was good. And then June dried out, got pretty warm, warmer than normal for several days. And then as we got into late July, early August, some pretty significant hailstorms came through the core pheasant region. And those definitely had an impact on habitat, and in some cases, actual birds being killed by hailstones. They're pretty similar to pheasants in terms of quail, whether it's bobwhite or scaled quail. Most of you are probably aware that the Southeast was extremely dry for a long period, starting last fall and continuing through roughly July this summer, this past summer. So that definitely has an impact on quail nest success and brood rearing. So we don't expect the quail to be as good as it has been the last 2 years in the Southeast. In the Northeast, it's really difficult to assess quail populations. Most of the quail are located along the South Platte River, and it's difficult to assess population there for a number of reasons. One thing the hunters will have to deal with is pretty significant cover on the South Platte River this year. The conditions are pretty thick, not as thick as 2 years ago, but thick and overgrown and difficult to find quail or to see quail when they flush. So population-wise, we're probably okay for the most part, but could be difficult hunting conditions. Enrolled in the walk-in access program this year, 160,000 acres, plus or minus a few. We're certainly down a little bit from previous years, but that is mostly due to the fact that one large ranch left the program this year. And we've really caught up with the CRP expiring acres that have kind of been a factor in other states. We've kind of hit that wall now where we've lost a lot of CRP. There's not much to replace it. One of the bright spots is in walk-in is we've added 300 new sprinkler corners over the last 3 years that are planted to really good wildlife habitat. Those are all in the Access Atlas. They're not identified as such, but you'll see them. If you compare years or different versions of atlases, you'll definitely see the new corners in there. And ultimately, I think habitat looks pretty good across those. So walk-in access is a program that depends on strong partnerships with private landowners. And hunters can play a huge role in helping us maintain those partnerships by doing a few simple things or not doing some things on properties. One of those is leaving trash. Some of the things that really catch a landowner's eye are pop cans or water bottles or empty shotgun holes in the road. Those types of things, if you see them out there, you can really help by just picking them up, putting them away, and throwing them away when you get home or get back to the motel. Second on that list is no bird cleaning on properties. Just put them in your game vest, and when you get to the vehicle, right back in the cooler they go. Some of the properties that we lease in the walk-in program are accessible only by two-track roads, which are largely unimproved, unmaintained road system out here. Things get pretty muddy and slippery really quick when it's been a dry fall, but a little bit of moisture would change that around where that top couple inches gets really soft. And the resulting road damage can really cause people to think twice whether they want to put in another property that has difficult access. Fire danger. It's been a pretty dry fall out here. Pay attention to where you park. Most walk-in properties do not have designated parking areas. You're expected to park out of the way along the road, and it kind of goes without saying, don't park in tall weeds or heavy grasses where we can have problems with a fire starting. If you smoke, it's best if you don't smoke in the fields. That's kind of a big one with landowners.